And now fertilizing. We won't talk about in great detail about fertility and fertilizing, because that is discussed in the soils chapter, because fertility has everything to do with the soil, and so that's the best place to talk about fertility. Fertility is the nutrients that plants need in order to then produce the elements, the food that they need to in order to grow. And the three main elements that plants need the most of are nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. And therefore, when you see a fertilizer product, you'll almost always see three numbers on them. And those three numbers stand for NPK, that is the analysis of the fertilizer, and it tells you the percentage of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium that is in that product. It is a percentage of the product that is nitrogen, the percentage of the product that is phosphorus, and the percentage that is potassium. K is the scientific notation for potassium. That gets a little bit confusing at first for people. And nitrogen is important for producing foliage, green leafy parts of the plant. Phosphorus produces strong roots. It also helps to encourage flowering. And so you'll see blossom boosters type fertilizers are usually fertilizers that have a higher phosphorus content. And then potassium helps plants to have better disease resistance and better winter hardiness. If you provide too much nitrogen, you may end up with all green leafy growth and no fruits, because you will probably discourage flowering. You'll produce leaves at the expense of flowering. I'll never forget my very first garden as an adult. I had a very small postage stamp area, and this is when I first decided I wanted to go into horticulture. And I planted a few tomato plants, and I primped and preened, and I gave them fertilizer, and my plants were taller than anybody else in the neighborhood. And I didn't have a single tomato. And that was because I gave them too much nitrogen, and all they did was produce leafy tissue, and they didn't produce any flowers and fruits. So I also find that people tend to fertilize too much, not just nitrogen, but other things as well, and feel like they have to be constantly fertilizing their plants in order for their plants to continually grow. Really, as kind of a general rule, fertilizing at the time of bed preparation, we talked about that with a granular fertilizer that you work into the soil surface, and then really every couple of years maybe is all you need for trees and shrubs and perennials. Annuals, yeah, you may need to fertilize them a couple of times during the growing season, but maybe only every 6 or 8 weeks. You don't have to fertilize them on a weekly basis, as is sometimes recommended by some fertilizer products. And when you do fertilize perennials in particular, doing it as the growth resumes in the spring is a good recommendation, because that's when the plants need to utilize these nutrients to develop the new plant. I'll talk a little bit more about formulation in a minute here with one of the other slides. All sorts of different kinds of fertilizer products out there for you, and like I say, they all have the NPK, the three numbers on them, but then how you deliver those to the plants can really, really vary. What we're seeing here, and Mike's doing such a good job with the pointer, let me see if I can do the pointer. Here's the pointer, and I'm going to put it right here. No, I'm not. It didn't work. Okay, well, that first hose with the jug next to it, thank you, Mike, for the pointer, is a proportioner type fertilizer. And it's real similar to what the gentleman is doing down below there, where he has a hose and a fertilizer bottle on the end of it. This one of them has the concentrated fertilizer in a bottle at the end of the hose. They call that a hose end fertilizer. Or they have it at the point where the water comes out from the spigot. And what that takes advantage of is the pressure of water coming through the hose, and that pressure then sucking this concentrated fertilizer out of the bottle, whether it be the bottle be at the beginning of the hose or the end of the hose, and then it gets mixed with the water from the hose and it's sprayed onto the plants. The one real disadvantage there is that you end up generally spraying that all over the plants, and fertilizer sprayed onto the leaves of plants goes in, penetrates the leaves at the point that it hits the plants, but it really isn't moved throughout the plant. Whereas fertilizer applied to the roots is taken up by the roots and moved throughout the entire plant. So I find with these hose end sprayers especially, you end up kind of having to spray all over the plants rather than directing it at the base of the plant so that the roots can take it up. Now those little cartridges with the hammer, those are fertilizer spikes, and these are, in particular, are spikes to use when fertilizing trees and shrubs. Now they have advantages and disadvantages. They tend to kind of fall apart when you push them into the soil. You can't just, in our heavy clay soils in this area, we can't just pound them in with a hammer and keep the spike from falling apart. You need to moisten the soil first. You may need to pre-drill some holes to put these things in. The Job spikes are something that people are familiar with that are used for container gardening, where you push the little spikes into the container media, which is very easy to do. And then they break down slowly over time as they get moist. The far right-hand picture, the Peters, this one's called Super Blossom Booster. I don't see the analysis on that particular package, but I imagine it's a very high phosphorus level. And that is a soluble fertilizer. Soluble fertilizers are fertilizers that are intended to be dissolved in water and then the plant watered with it. And that water should be placed at the base of the plant. So starter fertilizers are done this way. They're usually a soluble fertilizer that's mixed with water, and then the plant is watered with that. And that's what the little boy down below is doing with his watering can, is watering some plants that have just been planted with a starter fertilizer. And then in the middle picture on the bottom is a broadcast fertilizer, and this gentleman has taken a 5-gallon bucket and filled it with his fertilizer, and then he can simply walk along and take handfuls and broadcast it or sprinkle it all over the surface of the garden area, and then that can be worked in lightly, and that's your pre-plant fertilizer. This is not a good method to use for lawn fertilizer. Don't ever try to fertilize even a small patch of lawn by hand broadcasting fertilizer. You will never have a good even result. So that's one thing to try to avoid. But otherwise, a granular fertilizer works very nicely for a broadcast pre-plant. And then there's the issue of synthetic fertilizers and organic fertilizers. Synthetic fertilizers are those fertilizers that have been synthesized from some mineral product and are usually in the form of salts. Those salts dissolve very readily in water. They also contain high proportions of the nutrients, and they are very readily available to the plants at the time that these are applied. So they're very advantageous to get very quick results when a plant is really suffering from a nutrient deficiency. It's a very easy way to fertilize. They also are very inexpensive, pound for pound of nitrogen or pound per pound of phosphorus or potassium. Synthetic fertilizers are going to be much cheaper because you have a much higher analysis. You can see on the Howard Johnson's fertilizer product that we have 28% nitrogen in that one and 21% ammonium sulfate. You have 21% nitrogen in that one. And so in a very small volume, you have quite a bit of the nutrient that you need. The problem with that is that because they are so readily available and because they are salts, they tend to have the potential to burn plant roots and plant leaves, plant tissue that they're applied to. So you do have to exercise caution with that. And because they're soluble, they tend to also wash into local waterways and then lead to a lot of pollution problems due to excess nitrogen and phosphorus waterways from local lakes and streams. So that's some of the disadvantages of synthetic fertilizers, and then also the way that they are mined and manufactured. Those processes often are not real friendly to the earth that those products are being extracted from. And so those are some of the concerns that organic gardeners have about synthetic fertilizers. On the other hand, organic fertilizers are fertilizers that come from a living source or a formerly living source, or they're a byproduct of a living source, like manure. And these are oftentimes very inexpensive because they're free. So when you have a load of manure that you can get and apply to your garden, that's a great deal. But sometimes getting that hauled and moved is difficult or expensive to do. So they can end up being more expensive, plus the nutrient contents are much lower. So in manure, you may have 6% nitrogen per pound versus 21% nitrogen in the ammonium sulfate. And so it's a much larger volume, and then transportation can become more expensive, and you need more of it to get the same amount of nitrogen. But it does have the advantage often of having some organic material that comes along with it, and that organic matter improves the soil. The nutrients are the same whether it's a synthetic or an organic fertilizer. The plant doesn't know the difference because plants can only take up those nutrients when they are in a specific plant available form. And with a synthetic fertilizer, it is already in that plant available form, and so the nutrients can be taken up immediately. In an organic fertilizer, those nutrients are in much more complex molecules. And those complex molecules need to be broken down so that the plant available nutrients can be released from the product and then be available to and be used by the plants. So it takes longer for them to break down, and that adds to part of the safety of using organic fertilizers. They don't tend to burn as much because they're not salts. They also don't contribute to pollution because they are not as soluble and don't leach into the groundwater. So there are organic and inorganic forms of
It's just more of a point of clarification regarding manures. You just said that using a organic source like manure can cut down on burning, but can you please address how some manures can be considered too hot to use and can burn plants as well?
Well, that's a really good point. Thanks for bringing that up. Manures that have not been composted contain a lot of ammonium. And that ammonium can burn plants very easily. It's very high in nitrogen, it's very soluble, and that's the aspect that can burn plants. So if it's not a composted manure, if it's a fresh manure, it can very easily burn plants. So that's a good point, that manures need to be composted before being applied to a garden area. And particularly if it's a vegetable garden area, it's critically important that they are composted because of disease organisms that you need to be concerned about.